Good morning, Bridge. We're glad you're here this morning. Stand up with us. So we bring a lot of energy to this morning service with your grace is enough. There we go.
Great is your faithfulness, O God. You wrestle with the sinner's restless heart. You lead us by still waters into mercy. And nothing can keep us apart. So remember your people. Remember your children. Remember your promise, oh God. Your love and justice, God of Jacob.
Sing it out.
You use the weak to lead the strong. You lead us in the songs of your salvation. And all your people sing along. So remember your people, remember your children, remember your promise, oh God.
Let's sing it out.
Your grace is enough. Your so God,
your grace is enough.
Sing it out.
Your grace is enough. Heaven reaches down to us. Your grace is enough for me. God, I'll see your grace is enough. I'm covered in your love. Your grace is enough for me.
Your grace is enough for me.
Everybody may be seated.
Hi, Lily. It's so good to see you. I've been looking forward to this day so much. Would you want to come up with me? Your mom and dad can come up and stand up here too, okay?
Okay. And afterwards, there is a bag that you can help unwrap.
Oh, boy. All right. It's so special. Pardon me? Godparent? Oh, yeah. Sorry about that, Ashley.
Oh, my gosh, that's
fine. Yeah. Okay. What a treat to be able to baptize Lily. So, all right. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ gave his church the command to baptize when he said, "All authority in heaven and earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you." Christ's almighty word gives baptism its power to save. The Apostle Peter declares, "Baptism now saves you also." Scripture clearly teaches that the power and promise of baptism is intended for young and old alike. On the day of Pentecost, the Apostle testified, "The promise is for you and your children and for all who are far off, for all whom the Lord our God will call. By water and the Spirit we are born again and united with Christ and his people as members of the church." I talked with Eric and Lily, Eric and Katie, about baptism. And I just love the whole idea that in baptism we're clothed with Christ. Galatians 3, that as many of us have been baptized into Christ have been clothed with Christ. And that when God the Father said to his Son on Jesus' baptism day, he said, "You are my Son, whom I love, with you I am well pleased." And if in our baptisms we get to put on a Jesus coat, then what does the God the Father see? He sees the perfection of Jesus, right? That perfect forgiveness. And in baptism, God's making a promise to Lily, but to every one of us, if we just remember, that he is saying to us, "You are my Son, my daughter, whom I love, with you I am well pleased." And as a godparent, guess what? It's your privilege and responsibility to help Lily remember, because we wish that Lily would always have great days and never struggle to believe that she's loved and well-pleased by God. It's your joy, as well as really the rest of us, to remind her the promise that God gives to her today is a promise that lasts forever. It's not a one-time promise. "You are my daughter, whom I love, with you I am well pleased." Now, I don't know about you, but I need to hear that every day. So God bless us as we encourage all of us as baptized children of God. So let's confess the faith into which Lily will be baptized. We'll use the Apostles' Creed. Our oldest copy of the Apostles' Creed dates from about 150 AD. It was a confession of faith that the early Christian church used at baptisms. So let's join with the church across the ages and confess the faith into which Lily is baptized. "I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen." Okay, Lily, receive the sign of the cross on head and heart to signify you as a redeemed child of Christ, right? Mm-hmm. So now I'm going to put just a little bit of water on your head to baptize you, okay? So your dad can just carry you right on over here.
Oops. I forgot a baptismal napkin. But we don't have a baptismal napkin, but we will drive you off with a napkin, and then your baptismal napkin will be absolutely pristine. So Mom and Dad, you better come on over here too so that you can see this too. Ready? Ready, Lily? Okay. I baptize you in the name of the Father, whoops, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Oh, so good, so good. You're so grown up, Lily. My goodness sakes. Okay. The Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit has forgiven you all your sins. By your baptism, you're born again and made a dear child of your Father in heaven. May God strengthen you to live in your baptismal grace all the days of your life. Peace be with you, Lily. Amen. Okay. And now, Mom and Dad, godparent, but all of us as Lily's brothers and sisters in Christ, I ask you, will you do all that you can so that Lily remains a child of God until death? If you are willing to carry out this responsibility, then answer yes, and we ask God to help us. Yes, and we ask God to help us. And should we pray, Lily? Should we pray? Okay. Can I hold prayer? We'll fold hands together. Okay. Lord God, Heavenly Father, thank you for adopting Lily into your family. And we ask that you would help her every day to claim again the marvelous promise that she is clothed in her Son, perfectly forgiven. Let your Holy Spirit rest upon her, strengthen her in her faith, preserve her until life everlasting. Use her powerfully in your kingdom to bless her family and to bless your world. All this we ask in Jesus our Savior's name. Amen. Congratulations, Lily. What a celebration of God's grace. You guys can be seated. And Mike, I'll let you take it away.
God's got a plan for our faith, and I know he works in my life with trust and really thinking about how we can move forward. Seeing a baptism is a reminder of faith and the walk that God has intentions with us. We also, as a music group, we all get together and we pray about service and we work on that. And actually, I'm playing bass today because Tim had to go home sick. He's not feeling good. First time that happened was the first time I ever played with Mike Westendorf. Charlie was on drums at a church and got sick, and I jumped on drums. That was the first time I ever played with him. And as I continue to walk in my faith, I see like where God continues to put me and meet with people. So I'm using Pastor Bonock's bass. I've got Ronnie's pick. I've got this memory of how God walks in my life with me and carries me. I get to see a baptism. We're missing a napkin, and we've got one right in the front row. God has this planned out for us. And so sometimes when we're doubting or we're thinking about what's going to happen next, thank God I can play bass, and thank God I've got a community of musicians that can wrap around this, and thank God that we have all of us that are supporting each other in this walk, and we have God that carries us. So that was a memorable service. I know this one is going to be one we don't forget. This nice family here, this nice community here, this group that we're surrounded by. Let's stand and sing Walking Free as we think about that God allows us to be free. Do we believe these words? Do we believe what we're singing? Let's do this together.
Verdict was guilty, case closed, the end. No chance for me to ever leave this prison of my sin. Now I know it might sound crazy, but one day a key unlocked the cell. I heard a small voice say your debt's been paid by somebody else. And now I'm walking, walking. When mercy called my name, ain't nothing perfect. I still stumble every single day. Still get knocked down, but the difference now is that's not where I stay. 'Cause there is a Savior who knows everywhere I've been, and he's telling me that I never have to go back there again. So now I'm walking, walking, walking free. No more darkness, guilt has lost its grip on me. When mercy called my name, those chains fell at my feet, and now I'm walking, walking, walking. Regret. Look up and see your victory is just up ahead. There is a Savior who knows everywhere you've been, and he's telling you that you never have to go back there again. So if you know that you never have to go back there again, then sing, I'm walking, walking.
You may have a seat.
I love the way the chosen screenwriters captured that event from John chapter 4. And the Apostle John was there that day. He saw that life-changing encounter between the Messiah and this woman at the well. A lifetime later, John finally records it. He was probably 20 at the most when he saw this encounter, and he recorded it in his 90s because it made such an impression. Because that encounter changed this woman dramatically. She went out to that well with the deep desire that people would look past her mistakes, not see them. That was her desire on the way out. On the way back to the village, her desire was completely different. Her deepest desire was to use what everybody knew about her, all of her failings, so that they could experience the Savior like she did. She knew that the Savior's deep desire for her had created a deep desire in her.
John wanted his readers to experience that same kind of encounter. In fact, as he writes in 1 John, you know, we're looking at the Go Deeper series. We're digging into 1 John. And when the Apostle John wrote, he knew that his first readers had that kind of life-changing experience, just like that woman did. This is what he wrote. He said, "I'm writing to you, dear children, because your sins have been forgiven on account of his name." You've had that experience. "I'm writing to you, fathers, because you know him who is from the beginning. You know that the Messiah is the Son of God who was there with the Father at the creation of the world. He is the eternal God. I'm writing to you, young men, because you have overcome the evil one. You have this power because of your interaction with the Savior that you can take Satan on and defeat him." And then, like a poet, he says it again. "I write to you, dear children, because you know the Father. You have this marvelous relationship with God, your Father. I write to you, fathers, because you know him who is from the beginning. I write to you, young men, because you are strong and the Word of God lives in you and you have overcome the evil one." You have had this encounter that has changed your life. And many of us are here today. Many of you are watching online because you too have had that life-changing encounter with the Messiah. But the aged Apostle John is writing because that change can be lost. This is how he goes on. "Do not love the world or anything in the world. If anyone loves the world, love for the Father is not in them. For everything in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, comes not from the Father, but from the world. The world and its desires pass away, but whoever does the will of God lives forever." The lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. There are so many things that we see in this world that can just become a desire for us. And even though we've had this life-changing encounter with the Savior, we can lose that passion. We can lose that deep desire that, "Lord, the only thing that really matters is my continuing relationship with you." We can lose that because of the desires of the world around us. And so the Apostle John is writing to his spiritual children in the first century AD. And because the Holy Spirit preserved these words, he is writing also to his spiritual children of the 21st century. And he is warning us and encouraging us every day to go back to our encounter with the Savior, that the Savior's deep desire for us might create in us every day a deep desire for him. Now I'd like to change the picture. What we saw was a first century well outside of a Samaritan village. Now I'd like to take a look at a 21st century city. Do you recognize that building? It's the Burj Khalifa, tallest building in the world. Now, I'm going to ask you three questions just to kind of acquaint you with this building. The first one is, how tall is the Burj Khalifa? So I've set this up kind of like when you're at the baseball stadium. Who says A? Who says B? Who says C? Who says D? What do you think? C, you are correct. 2,722 feet tall. Over half a mile high. Woo! Next question. The Burj Khalifa was built on top of the sand on a raft of concrete 12 feet thick. True or false? False. True. Trick question. It is true. There is the raft, they call it. Right on top of the sand, right? Of course, underneath that raft is 194 pillars or piles that go down to bedrock, 5 feet in diameter, 141 feet deep. You know, to go high, you have to go really deep. One last question. The Burj Khalifa was built 2,722 feet high because Dubai is running out of land. True or false? You do a satellite image of Dubai and you go, you drive a couple of miles and there is all kinds of desert. There's plenty of room. Why did they go up so high? You see, the Burj Khalifa, to me, is the picture of, oops, went too far, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. It was built that high so that the world would admire the builder, the city, the emirate. You know, it's in so many ways just like the Tower of Babel so long ago. Look at me. So, why am I talking about the Burj Khalifa? Because it's a picture of you. It's a picture of me. It's a picture of this woman by the well 2,000 years ago. You see, we all want to build our lives in a way that people look up to us. It's important what other people think about us. The things of this world we tend to want for ourselves so that people will look up to us. And this woman at the well, she wanted people to look up to her too. It crushed her heart that people despised her. And so she began to build a raft of concrete. This is part of the reason why I loved just the way the screenwriters put this account into The Chosen. When somebody sits in judgment over you, one of the ways to feel better, to make your raft seem stronger, is to judge other people. That's what the woman did in that account, right? Jesus, it's people like you who cause me trouble. Here you are judging me. See, I feel better if I compare myself with you and can judge you. Aren't you thankful she's the only one in the whole wide world who does that? Woo! None of us do that, right? Oh, wait a second. We all tend to build those rafts on the sand of comparison. I feel better when I compare myself with you. And so Jesus does something that's surprising. Jesus hurts this woman. He says, go call your husband. Oh, you're right when you say you have no husband. You don't have a husband. Why did Jesus hurt this woman by talking to her this way? Because he was pulling the sand out from underneath her raft, right? Helping her see that she needed a better foundation for her life than comparisons. You know, Earlier in my life, when I was reading through the Old Testament, I realized that I spent a lot of time reading through the Old Testament kind of going like, man, what kind of people were they? I mean, God fed them with manna for 40 years. In Deuteronomy 8, we're told that for 40 years, their feet didn't swell. They got water out of the rock. How could they doubt him? How could they forget him when they moved into the promised land and had all the wealth of the world to enjoy in the promised land? How could they forget? And then I realized, oh, yeah. I'm just building myself, my raft on a sand of comparison that somehow I'm better than them. No, I'm not. I just pull out a couple of passages here. I love Genesis chapter 8. Every inclination of a person's heart is only evil from childhood. When I taught the membership Bible study, Pastor Nate teaches it now, but when I taught the membership Bible study, I like to use this first sentence as an agree or disagree sentence, and almost everybody disagreed, you know, so that is way too judgmental. It's way too hopeless. And then it's like, well, Jesus, God said that in Genesis chapter 8 about all of us. Or the heart is deceitful above all things and beyond cure. What is God doing? He isn't revealing the faults and failures of God's Old Testament people so that we can build a sand of comparison. He is helping us see that we are just like them. He's trying to pull out the sand foundation that we build our lives on, that somehow we'll be good enough for God. He's trying to pull that sand out. So that we realize we need a better foundation than the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. And so, God gives us a better foundation. In John's Gospel, he summarizes the bedrock of our faith so well. Let's read it together. This is love. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Love isn't about us comparing ourselves with somebody else and going, well, I love God more than you, so I better be, you know, I'm doing okay because I love God better than you for sure. No. Love is all about going back to the bedrock, the Savior, the Son of God, who is the atoning sacrifice. An atoning sacrifice that takes you back to the Old Testament great day of atonement in Leviticus chapter 6, where the high priest would put his hands on the head of a goat and he would confess the sins of the people on that goat, and then that goat would die and he would take the blood and he would take it into the most holy place and sprinkle it on the Ark of the Covenant, the mercy seat, the places of atonement, of payment. Trouble is, that had to be repeated year after year because no goat is enough to truly pay for sins. You and I have this bedrock. The one who died for us, the one who takes all of the guilt and shame of this woman, the guilt and shame that you and I have. We put our hands on the head of the God who was there with the Father at the beginning, who's the eternal God who died for us. That's the rock-solid foundation for our faith. You and I are forgiven. This is love. God loves us. So test that foundation. Earlier in chapter 4, John writes, "Dear friends, do not believe every spirit, but test the spirits to see whether they are from God." It's interesting, as you read about the building of the Burj Khalifa, how many tests that they ran to make sure that bedrock would be sufficient to support the building. You know, the woman tested Jesus as the Messiah, right? She didn't believe him right away. She tested him. Test the spirits. Search the scriptures so that you can be convinced. Then search the scriptures even more so that you are prepared when the devil uses lies to deceive you. He says, dear friends, do not believe every spirit, but test the spirits to see whether they are from God, because many false prophets have gone out into the world. This is how you can recognize the Spirit of God. Every spirit that acknowledges that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is from God, but every spirit that does not acknowledge Jesus is not from God. This is the spirit of the Antichrist, which you have heard is coming and even now is already in the world. In John's day, the lie the devil used was, Jesus isn't really God. That there was this man, Jesus, that this God-like thing, the Christ entered into Jesus, but before Jesus suffered and died, the Christ left him, and the person who died was just a man. And as you read through John's gospel, John's letters, and the revelation that Jesus gives to John, you will see so clearly that the Apostle Paul is hammering home the one who died for us is Jesus Christ, the promised Messiah, who is the Son of God. Today, the devil uses a lot of different ways to make us wonder, is it really true? And it's hard work to search the scriptures and know for sure is something true. You know, last night, one of our members, Linda, came out and showed me a picture on her phone. I was just at the top of the Burj Khalifa. This is the picture. All right. Would you go to the top of the Burj Khalifa if, you know, the architect or I was told it's really the engineers who do this, so you engineers present, bear with me. But if the builder said, you know what, the plans require 194 piles down to bedrock, but that's going to be really a lot of work and a lot more expense than what we want to spend, so let's cut them in half. Let's just put half of these pillars in, or we can save even more money if we just put in a quarter, because nobody will really care, nobody really sees it, right? Would you still go up to the top of the Burj Khalifa? Maybe not. The bedrock is Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, who died for you and me. You're forgiven. And all the pillars are all the different scriptures or teachings of Scripture that connect us with that bedrock. And sometimes in our world today, people are going, well, maybe it's not that important that you believe that God created the world, or maybe it's not that important that you believe that the power of baptism, that it's benefiting Lily, even though she maybe doesn't fully understand, right? Maybe it's not important that you believe that Jesus' body and blood are present in the Lord's Supper. Maybe it's not important if whatever it is that you struggle with, well, maybe I don't have to really believe it. What are you doing? Are you pulling out some of the pillars? Your connections to the bedrock. And when you start to do that, then the building gets unsteady. That's what the devil wants us to do. It's just too much work to search the scriptures, to read the Bible, to be ready when Satan throws some false teaching that we're attuned to knowing God's word well enough that we go, no, that's not right. But that's what the devil wants to do, is he just wants to have us have some questions. Because if he can lead us to question our connection with the foundation, then the deep desire gets lost. And brothers and sisters, we need the deep desire that this woman had. We need that deep desire. If God in his grace says, I am going to build your life like this magnificent tower. I think that's what all of us want. Don't we want God to just bless us in marvelous ways so that every person within our area of influence looks at us and goes, man, I want what that person has. I want to know the Jesus that person knows. But what if God's plan is that your life looks more like this? This is the Burj Khalifa, right, as they just started building on top of the raft. What if that's where God says, that's as much as I'm going to build? What if God in his wisdom says, I'm going to be best glorified by you by revealing your failures? Wow. I need to go down deep to be ready for that, don't you think? Because that's going to be a whole lot harder than going up to the skies. You know, early in my ministry, I read a book that taught me to pray as I stepped into the pulpit, Lord, you be all and me be nothing. If you are best glorified by you building me up, great, because it's all about you. And if you're best glorified by revealing my failures and flaws, that's okay too. Because I've learned your deep desire for me, Savior. And I have a deep desire for you because of that. So let's search the scriptures to be convicted, just like this woman at the well was. Where have you built your hopes and your confidence on a raft of sand? Search the scriptures so that you can be convinced that Jesus is that bedrock that is absolutely sure that you are forgiven, and then search the scriptures so that Jesus' deep desire becomes our deep desire. I'd like to close with the last little bit of that clip from The Chosen, where we see how that encounter at the well changed this woman's desires. May he miraculously change our desires, that it is truly all about him.
So unusual, it's frightening. You see right through the mess inside me, and you call me out, pull me in, tell me I can start again. And I don't need to keep on hiding. I'm fully known and loved by you. You won't let go. No matter what I do, and it's not one or the other, hard truth and ridiculous grace to be known, fully known and loved by you. I'm fully known and loved by you. So like you to keep pursuing. It's so like me to go astray. But you got my heart with your truth, that kind of love that's bulletproof. And I surrender to your kindness. I'm fully known and loved by you. You won't let go. No matter what I do, and it's not one or the other, hard truth and ridiculous grace to be known, fully known and loved by you. I'm fully known and loved by you. How real, how wide, how rich, how high is your heart? I cannot find the reasons why you give me so much. How real, how wide, how rich, how high is your heart. I cannot find the reasons why you give me so much. I'm fully known and loved by you. You won't let go, no matter what I do. And it's not one or the other. How truth and ridiculous grace to be known, fully known and loved by you. I'm fully known and loved by you. It's so unusual, it's frightening. Fully known and loved by you. Amen.
Amen. Let's stand for prayer. Oh, Lord, thank you for just reminding us that we don't have to hide, that we are fully known. You see that woman's sins at the well, you see ours. And still you went to the cross and paid for them all. No surprises. You just know it all and you forgive it all. And so we ask, Lord, that your deep desire for us would every day change us. That the passion that we experienced perhaps the first time we had a powerful encounter with you, or maybe just a couple of days ago, it was great and now it's not. Lord, every day, give us that powerful encounter with you again through your word, through your sacraments, and change us so that ultimately it's just all about you and letting you be fully known to the people around us. Lord, you are the Almighty God. And there's some times that we just go, I don't understand why you did this. I don't understand why a hurricane like Ian could rush on shore and take so many lives and destroy so much, and so many of us have family and friends who have been impacted by that storm. We don't know, we don't understand, but we trust your love. And we ask that in your grace and mercy, you would grant healing to those who have been injured, comfort those who have lost loved ones, and let your protecting arms be around those who are dealing with the aftermath, so that they're just not overwhelmed emotionally and spiritually by the weeks and months and years of rebuilding. We place them into your powerful hands. And then, Lord, we ask that you would work in us, that we would respond in generous ways too, to help those in need. All this we ask because you're our Savior, and in your name we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. And the grace of the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace. And we respond in faith. Amen.
We had a jam-packed service today, and we know that it's gone a little longer. And it's hard to stop a good thing, right? But if you feel that you need to duck out early, we still love you. But if you want to join us in this last song, it's Mighty to Save, and it just encapsulates who Jesus is in our lives and that he fully knows us. Sing along.
everyone needs compassion, a love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. And everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a savior, the hope of nations. Bridge, sing it out.
Savior, he can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave.
So take me as you find me, all my fears and failures, and fill my life again. I give my life to follow everything I believe in. Now I surrender. We surrender, Lord. Savior, he can move the mountains. My God is mighty.
Have a wonderful rest of your day. Blessings. Enjoy your week. We'll see you here next time. If you wouldn't mind grabbing a chair, actually, and helping to place it over on this side of the room, that would be helpful, too. We love seeing all of you here. Thanks for your help, also.
Started out in life, had to have it my way. Don't tell me to wait. I found the world just doesn't revolve around me. Created for the glory of the King of Kings, I sure missed my call. I'm here to live out my life for his name. 'Cause in Jesus I find grace. You are my joy. dreams of my day, I don't always see him. Moments in my life where my soul turns gray. Blowing like a reed swaying in the wind, give me a strong foundation. I need to find a shelter again. 'Cause in Jesus I know I can. You are my joy. My